Hey, it's Fran in the virtual space. With some news, I got an email today from MakerGear because, as some of you may know from watching videos from the old lab, I do have a MakerGear M3 printer, which I've only just recently reset up in its very own dedicated room here in the 3.0. And the email was pretty short. Basically saying that MakerGear is shutting down. They have a link which redirects to the website, and there is an article that they posted today, The Future of MakerGear. They said, due to significant supply chain disruptions, higher costs, and long lead-in times, it's become too problematic for MakerGear to keep printers in stock. We can't get parts and/or they've become too expensive. Additionally, this is the second major supply chain disruption in the last 4 years. The first disruption resulted from the tariffs that started in 2018, and there was COVID in between, and some of the tariffs are still in place and continuing to add cost. In order to deal with the challenges, they've scaled back operations, and at this moment we are selling our existing printer inventory, trying to maintain a consistent stock of spare parts and providing technical support. And basically, they said they're looking for someone to acquire MakerGear. They've got several things in their letter about they're willing to make a deal. They also said, they've been in business for 14 years. It's not an uncommon tale in 2022 for American companies to be shuttering simply because they built their company model on being dependent on outsourcing to China. Even Tesla, Elon Musk had made an announcement just this past week. It's been printed in many papers about how his new factories that they built, particularly the factory that they built for the new Tesla truck, it caused them money furnaces because of COVID lockdowns in China. The supply chain disruptions, particularly with batteries and battery parts, I think is one of the big issues. Companies all around the United States are either scaling back or cutting losses or shutting down altogether because their company is dependent on supply chains that come from Asia and particularly mainland China. First thing people are going to ask about MakerGear is, well, are MakerGear printers going to become bricked? I do not think that's possible because it is an open source printer. So it runs on Octoprint, which, can't really go dark. So I'm not concerned about the printers being bricked, but obviously replacement parts are going to be a thing as time goes on, not having the support. I think that's really what they're concerned with or voicing concern. I'm sure their primary concern is going out of business, but as a company that's been around for a while and has a lot of printers out there, mine just being one of them, it seems that they're particularly concerned about the future of spare parts availability and support. I guess we'll just have to see. It's a shame about MakerGear. I did spend a lot of time making that decision to buy the M3. I did have my issues with it, but it wasn't because of anything with the design of the M3. It was really the idea that the M3 was it was designed around a mindset that's a very young mindset of having things controlled with a phone, having things on the cloud. Not having things dedicated, autonomous, internal. It was a design philosophy that incorporated a lot of, what younger generations want. Wireless, decentralized, you control it with a smartphone. All those things I don't do. I like the idea of autonomous systems that operate on their own, that you don't have to, hook up to a computer to operate. The M3 you do. And that you don't have to have a cloud or Wi-Fi to control these things. The shape or origin, kind of the same way. Connects to Wi-Fi, although the shaper, fortunately, is autonomous on its own. Once you have it set up, you can disconnect it from the Wi-Fi. It'll operate on its own. But the M3 itself, the printer, is a great printer, well-designed, well-built. I imagine there will be more of this kind of thing as the tariffs and COVID continue to shut down. It does beg the question, when, if ever, are we going to bring critical manufacturing back to the U.S.? People ask this a lot, and of course the answer to that question is probably never, because although supply chain disruptions are killing small companies, they're not killing the big companies. And the big companies that actually drive the engine of Chinese manufacturing, they're playing the long game, and they're going to wait out the supply chain disruptions, and they're going to wait out the COVID lockdowns with the idea that, oh, in 5 years, 10 years, we'll be able to do business as usual and get the cheap parts from China at, you know, high volumes. In the meantime, the small companies that are also dependent on China are just, they're just going to be wiped off the face of the earth, because they're not going to be able to get the parts, they're not going to be able to get the services, and the big companies are pretty much taking the lion's share of that. But the reason that manufacturing stopped in the United States was because making anything in the U.S., that's tools, microchips, all the things that people are saying, oh, we got to bring back here, we got to start making steel in the U.S. again. Well, you know, you can't just turn on the blast furnaces in Bethlehem and get Allentown churning out steel again. Once you take away those factories, once you shut them down, once you knock down the infrastructure, you can't just turn it on again. It would take trillions of dollars and decades to bring back steel plants, to bring back microchip manufacturing. These, you can't just turn these things on. So when big companies look at the price tag of that, and it's a very long, long arc of return, they just say, we'll wait it out, and China will be back online, and we'll just keep buying from them. So no, I don't expect anything to change. It's a problem whose solution is just too expensive, affects the bottom line too much. This was a devil's bargain that was made decades ago, when American manufacturing was drop by drop, bit by bit, thrown overseas, and American companies that existed for decades slowly died off one by one. And you don't just get them back, you don't just turn them back on. So I'm sorry to hear about MakerGear. Hopefully they'll get an investor or something, or get acquired, and at least be able to provide support and such. I don't know if you've seen the documentary that was up. I don't know, was it the last year, about the 3D printing, the sordid history and the battles and between 3D printing companies, particularly MakerBot. They highlighted a lot of that. the halt and catch fire kind of, you know, evolution and backstabbing and an implosion and explosion of those printing companies. I think the problem is that there are so many entities, so many fingers in the 3D printing pot, that in any one particular 3D printer company, the value of it in the marketplace as an investment, I would not want to be in MakerGear's position trying to find a buyer, but maybe they'll luck out. I wish them the best. So yeah, I haven't even done a 3D printing video yet this year, because with the new lab being set up, like I said, I've got the M3 and a new baking oven for the filament in its own printing room in the new space. Haven't done a video about it yet, but I guess I'll have to go easy on the M3. Hopefully I won't have any breakdowns. Right. To be continued. So anyway, that's it. Thanks, everyone. Thanks to all the patrons on the Patreon for making this and all the videos possible. I really could not do any of this without all of the support on Patreon. So if you like anything that I do, consider becoming a patron. Follow the link in the description. I'll thank you personally. All right. I'll see you in the real lab, not the virtual space, real soon. Bye!
the lab. Go berserk. In my lab, it's where I work. Working at the bench.